This video is sponsored by Surfshark.
Detecting multiple Leviathan class life forms in the region. Are you certain whatever you're doing is working?
The Mesozoic was terrifying, and ichthyosaurs were one of the biggest reasons why. Ichthyosaurs are what happened when evolution took the blueprints for an orca, an eel, and a lizard and put them in the blender. Predatory marine reptiles that spanned nearly the entire Mesozoic, ichthyosaurs were incredibly diverse and successful, and may have been even older than we thought. A new study reports large-bodied ichthyosaurs from only 2 million years after the end-Permian extinction, implying that ichthyosaurs likely evolved in the Permian and developed large sizes very quickly. Growing huge was far from their only talent, however. This video will focus on the mega ichthyosaurs that dominated the Triassic and early Jurassic, looking at their physical adaptations, ecology, and what we know about their lives. There's also some juicy unpublished info I've gotten permission to share. For the sake of the video, I'll define a mega ichthyosaur as any ichthyosaur that reached a maximum body mass of 15 tons or more. And for any documentary producers watching this, please highlight the Triassic more. As this DeviantArt user noted, there's no other time period on Earth that gave us Subnautica-worthy super predators. What made the giant ichthyosaurs so successful in Triassic, and why did they disappear? The last mega ichthyosaurs like Temnodontosaurus were gone after the early Jurassic, replaced by smaller models like Ophthalmosaurus. Perhaps the giant forms were less able to compete with smaller predators like plesiosaurs, or their own relatives proved to be better suited to the Jurassic environment. The true giants didn't last through the end-Triassic extinction, which according to a 2012 study wiped out conodonts and severely damaged populations of other small invertebrates. Lowered oxygen levels, toxicity, and acid-laced seawater all would have contributed to the damage, which likely had its root in undersea volcanic activity. Those invertebrates would have been the basis for small to medium predators, which in turn would have been the chief food source for giant macro-predatory ichthyosaurs. They would have been unable to survive when a huge chunk of their food supply no longer existed, although they seem to have been growing bigger and bigger up until the Triassic extinction. A recent analysis on Ichthyotitan severinensis revealed that both specimens of the 20 to 25 meter behemoth died right before the cataclysmic event, which was likely the cause for the global ichthyosaur nerf. Even though the ichthyosaurs never again reached their peak size, clearly it worked for them during the Triassic, although it's odd that they grew to such incredible sizes so quickly. There are huge gaps in the Triassic fossil record that need to be filled by more research. Clearly, there were gigantic sea-going hunters spread all across the world, so there must have been a consistent food supply until the mass extinction. Perhaps the giant ichthyosaurs excelled at hunting one another? While commonly depicted as fish or squid eaters, we know that at least some ichthyosaurs were capable of taking on prey nearly as large as they were. Guizhou ichthyosaurus was a Chinese ichthyosaur from the Carnian stage of the Triassic. Typically 5 to 7 meters in total length, it was large by modern carnivore standards, and was equipped with sharp conical teeth and long jaws. A 2013 study reported a 4.8 meter Guizhou ichthyosaurus that had killed, bitten apart, and swallowed a 4 meter thalattosaur. Despite this animal not matching the expected build or tooth style for an apex predator, it lacked serrated teeth and had a small head for its body, it was obviously capable of hunting more than just small or soft-bodied prey. Morphological analysis alone predicted it to be a cephalopod specialist. It probably also hunted cephalopods, of course, but this shows that it had a more diverse diet than expected. Even Bisonosaurus, another ichthyosaur traditionally interpreted as a delicate squid eater, may have been cannibalistic. The holotype was preserved with the remains of a smaller ichthyosaur inside of it. It was originally diagnosed as a pregnancy, but a 2020 study stated that, although this interpretation may be correct, it is possible that the vertebrae represent parts of a prey Myxosaurus because the vertebral centra are too well developed for an embryo of the developmental stage indicated by their size, the centra are fully developed. That case is not nearly as strong of evidence, however, given the uncertainty. And given how dangerous ichthyosaurs seem to be, you'd want to make sure your information was well protected if you ever visited the Mesozoic Ocean. That's why every marine time traveler should use Surfshark VPN, the sponsor of this video and the best way to protect your personal data from digital super predators. Data leaks are a common threat nowadays, just as they were in the Triassic. The hacker that stole Kylie Jenner's passwords was probably a Temnodontosaurus. They're shifty creatures. I don't know about you, but having a 30-foot ocean beast yoink my address and show up to my front door is not my idea of fun. Surfshark will be your shield to defend against ichthyosaurian infiltration. Use the link in the description and the code VIVIDEND to get 4 months free. There's no more need to fear hanging out with an ichthyotitan if you know that you're protected by Surfshark. It can also proactively protect you by checking areas online where your credit card data may have been exposed to hackers, letting you pull the rug out from under their feet before they can steal your lunch money. But there's more. Surfshark comes with monitoring for your email account so you can always be defended, and lets you connect to country-specific streaming services to let you watch the shows you like. Use the link in the description and my code VIVIDEN for an extra 4 months free of keeping yourself safe in the Mesozoic seas, which were likely more dangerous than many assume. A 2013 study demonstrated that ichthyosaurs were adapted for ram feeding, not suction feeding, which is what sperm whales use to capture giant squid. That same study concluded that shastasaurids likely weren't adapted for deep water hunting based on small apertures in their sclerotic rings compared to low-light hunters, and that's borne out by the comparative lack of large, soft-bodied prey in the Triassic. For context, Shonosaurus was long thought to be a strict cephalopod eater, but recent discoveries showed that it in fact had massive, deeply rooted, sharp teeth, and the animal was about 50 feet long. Kelly et al. 2022 states that the large size of Shonosaurus, together with new specimens preserving robust, sectorial teeth throughout the jaws, indicate a trophic role as a macrophageous raptorial predator that likely fed at least in part on large-bodied prey, i.e. the so-called cut guild, as opposed to previous suggestions of specialized filter feeding or suction feeding. It belonged to the same group as Guijo Ichthyosaurus, the Shastasaurids, and if its smaller relative's behavior is anything to go by, then Shonosaurus would have been capable of shredding large prey. The much larger Ichthyotitan, while fragmentary, has muscle attachment ridges on the posterior part of its jaw that are most similar to Shonosaurus, implying a similar macrophageous feeding mechanism. Early ichthyosaurs like Guijo Ichthyosaurus, which would have included the Triassic giants, likely used an anguilliform or eel-like swimming style, where they moved their entire body in a wave. That style had transitioned to a more efficient thuniform or tuna-like locomotion by the time of the Jurassic. Later ichthyosaurs' preserved integument indicates adaptations for high speed, but the biggest ichthyosaurs have very little information. The same 2019 study that assumed an eel-like swimming style for Triassic ichthyosaurs also found that the huge Shonosaurus was extremely energy efficient, even with a primitive tail structure. It performed favorably against much more advanced dolphin-like parvipelvian ichthyosaurs as well as bottlenose dolphins themselves. We don't know how fast the big Shastasaurids would have been, but cruising speed for the Jurassic thuniforms would have been comparable to tuna. Advanced variants like Temnodontosaurus would be absolute terrors, capable of moving at high speeds and ripping prey in half. Analysis of Jurassic ichthyosaurs indicate that ramming and tail strikes may have been common methods of intraspecific combat, and the impact was strong enough to break ribs. Perhaps that was one of many reasons that they developed blubber. Now that we've covered a lot of the background information, let's talk about the mega sea dragons themselves. This list includes the most well-studied genera, as well as some poorly preserved colossi, so buckle in. Our honorable mention is the Welsh giant. This fragmentary beastie was from the very early Jurassic and only consists of a massive radius. The author stated it was most similar to that of Shonosaurus and scaled it to between 12 and 15 meters in body length. Based on Darius Now's GDI of Shonosaurus, that would result in a mass of 13.1 to 25.6 tons. We'll be keeping track of body mass using the orca score, or scorca. How many 10,000 kilogram orcas it would take to equal one of each mega ichthyosaur. The Welsh giant has a scorca range of 1.3 to 2.56, since there's so much uncertainty involved when scaling from parts of a single fin. Next up is Temnodontosaurus trigonodon, the menace of the Jurassic. This super predator was from early Jurassic Western Europe, with the best preserved specimen, the Rutland Sea Dragon, hailing from the UK. It's an incredible fossil, and at just over 10 meters is almost entirely complete, but it's far from the biggest. The largest Temno specimens are fragmentary individuals from Germany, and would reach up to 16 meters and 21 tons if their vertebral measurements were reported correctly. I've heard that there may have been some measurement errors involved, but even discounting the huge band specimens, Temno still tops out at about 15 meters and 17 tons. That's a scorca of 1.7 plus, and would scale to a posterior bite force of 67,500 newtons, stronger than that of the biggest T-Rex specimens. Keep in mind that this placement may shift, however, and these estimates could be too high. We can call it another honorable mention. Now we go back in time to the Triassic, where we begin to see the true giants. Cypospondylus youngorum, from the Anisian of Nevada, boasts a mass of 17 to 22 tons. Originally, it was touted as weighing over 40 tons, but that was scaling from Shonosaurus, which was much more robustly built and resulted in inflated numbers. But a scorca of up to 2.2 is nothing to sneeze at. Cypospondylus was the ultimate eel-like ichthyosaur, with a long, sinuous body and powerful jaws. Its bite force was likely incredible. Scaling up from Temnodontosaurus indicates 92,000 newtons, although this may be too low, considering how much more robust Cypospondylus' skull is. One thing's for sure, it was quite the monster. Himalayasaurus tibetensis, however, may have represented the pinnacle of aquatic superpredators, not just for ichthyosaurs, but for the Mesozoic as a whole. As the name indicates, it was found in Tibet, and was essentially a super mosasaur. Himalayasaurus was a macropredatory shastasaur with specialized cutting teeth and was 15 meters long with a weight of 30 to 35 tons. Its wide skull and massive jaws made it perhaps the most cranially robust of any large ichthyosaur, and its bite would have been devastatingly powerful. Scaling up Temno, which again is likely an underestimate given Himalaya's far bulkier skull, yields over 100,000 newtons of bite force. In terms of raw power, this creature's bite was in the same league as a mid-sized Ototus megalodon. It wasn't the biggest ichthyosaur, but in my opinion represents an S-tier blend with its sleek but powerful build. And it looks like we're back to talking about Shonosaurus popularis. This 25-ton giant, as previously mentioned, is famous for dispelling the myth that giant ichthyosaurs were by necessity hunters of small prey. While they very likely did eat cephalopods and fish, given the contents of associated coprolites, the most recent research expands their menu. To paraphrase science writer Riley Black, while once regarded as the Triassic equivalent of a baleen whale, Shonosaurus is now better compared to a 50-foot ocean-going crocodile. They also traveled in huge groups, as we know from accumulations of up to 40 individuals in Nevada. Think a pod of less intelligent orcas, but they're each quadruple the size. Shastasaurus aconiensis is from Canada and a few million years later than Shonosaurus, and is also quite a bit larger. There's disagreement about if the holotype measures 18.6 or 21 meters, it seems to depend on which paleontologist you ask, so in order to be conservative, we'll be going with a lower estimate. It's a much more sleekly built animal than Shonosaurus, but its extra 3 meters give it a 14-ton advantage. This may be the only giant shastasaur that wasn't going after large-bodied prey, which again raises the question of if we just haven't found adults with teeth yet, or if they exploited an ecological opening we don't fully understand. Either way, both in morphology and ecology, it seems to be an exception rather than the rule. The following section explores more of the super enormous fragmentary ichthyosaurs. While poorly known, they represent possibly the biggest predators in the history of the world. Remember that scaling from fragments is always messy, so take the following estimates and ecological speculations with a heap of salt. While undoubtedly gigantic, the following animals have wide size ranges associated with them, and have so little material that we don't have a good understanding of their ecology. You have been warned. The first in this category is everyone's favorite tooth-scaled titan, the Swiss tyrant. Known mainly from a tooth found in, you guessed it, the Swiss Alps, scaling from Himalayasaurus teeth yields a size range of 47 to 55 tons and a length of approximately 18 meters. The study that reported the tooth also described a collection of ribs and vertebrae that belonged to a Shastasaurus-sized animal, and another that was closer to Shonosaurus-sized, but specifies that they can't confidently assign the tooth to the same taxon as either of the postcranial assemblages. Either way, this superpredator means that ichthyosaurs thrived as apex predators at least the size of humpback whales. The Swiss tyrant, frighteningly, is the smallest from this category. If all ichthyosaurs are the dragons of the deep, then the creatures that follow are the dragon titans. Huna's giant is pretty poorly known as well. It's just a big centrum, so we don't even have any teeth to tell what its diet was. Based on Shonosaurus, it would be quite massive, however. There's not much else to it. Ichthyotitan severnensis recently made headlines for being one of the biggest marine reptiles ever discovered, and although it's fragmentary, there is a strong case for it being genuinely enormous. Known from 3 partial jaws, it was between 20 and 25 meters long when scaling from related shastasaurids. The Lilstock monster was found by Paul de la Salle, whose input was very valuable in researching this video, and the blue anchor beast was discovered by 11-year-old Ruby Reynolds and her father Justin. A third Ichthyotitan serangular was recently discovered and has yet to be published, but I've received permission to share some information about it. We'll nickname it Ose, after the Maia of the Sea in Tolkien's mythos. Ose is about 15% larger than the Lilstock monster and blue anchor specimens, and is currently under study, so keep an eye out for more publications. 2 separate histology analyses found that both the Lilstock monster and blue anchor ichthyotitan specimens were engaged in active continuous growth at the time of death. I'm confident that they were reproductively mature already at that size, but this might mean that giant ichthyosaur growth strategies were similar to some cetaceans, which can also increase their body size well past sexual maturity. Ichthyosaur histology is poorly understood, however, and further research may provide greater understanding of where these animals were in their life history. It's also unknown if they were macropredatory or not, but it seems likely based on jaw muscle attachment similarities to Shonosaurus. Ichthyotitan's jaws were compared to carbon fiber reinforced materials in an article from the University of Bonn, and one of the authors on the first histology paper speculated that they could have rammed their prey like modern orcas. I received further clarification on the size of the remains from Paul, who mentioned that the complete serangular for the Lilstock monster would have measured 2.3 meters by itself. That indicates a jaw length of 3.5 to 4.5 meters, providing quite a range of size estimates. For a deeper analysis of this taxon in particular, check out my other recent giant ichthyosaur video. Sort of mixed together with Ichthyotitan is another giant from Britain, the Oust Colossus. While only known from one partial serangular, it's undeniably massive, at least 30% larger than the Lilstock and Blue Anchor specimens of Ichthyotitan, and up to 50% larger. There's not enough material to tell if it's the same taxon or not, but histology also indicates that the animal was still undergoing active growth when it died. Given the speculative nature of any reconstruction of such a fragmentary animal, there's a huge range of sizes and ecological niches that are possible for Oust. It may have been a predator of smaller prey, like shoals of fish or groups of medium-sized cephalopods, or a macropredator, taking on big vertebrates like a mythical monster summoned by the gods to wreak havoc in the Triassic Ocean. Another partial, much smaller serangular has been discovered in the area, but we don't know yet if it belonged to the same type of animal. Keep an eye out for more research in this area from Dean Lomax, Paul de la Salle, and their team. On to what is easily the most controversial animal on this list, Hector's ichthyosaur. Like most of you, I've always heard this creature mentioned and immediately dismissed it as that big vertebra that got sunk in a shipwreck in the 1800s, figuring out that we didn't know enough about it to even bother looking. This section is based on the Hector's ichthyosaur pamphlet by Ash, so credit goes to her for the incredibly in-depth research. In the 1870s, the geologist James Hector described a centrum 6 centimeters across and a partial 20 centimeter humerus of a reptile from Mount Potts, New Zealand. The centrum wasn't measured in the original paper, but it was clarified as measuring 6 centimeters in Fleming 1971. In 1877, Alexander McKay found more Mount Potts reptile material, but of a much larger scale. They included a massive but thin centrum, smaller centra, ribs, another partial humerus, and scales. Given that ichthyosaurs don't have scutes or scales, this may represent remnants of a prey item and be additional evidence for macropredation in giant ichthyosaurs, or could be a simple misidentification of material. The centra being so wide across, but so thin posteriorly to anteriorly is certainly odd, almost as if they were squashed, but further analysis of the measurements by Ash and Diocles figured out that the proportions are explained by how the measurements were taken. The vertebral length appears to have been measured at the concavity, making their true proportions in line with other giant shastasaurids. Additionally, the idea of the large material having been lost in the Matawaka shipwreck is a myth, as the ship sank in 1869 and Hector's ichthyosaur wasn't even described until 1871. However, apparently the gigantic vert was to be sent to Edward Drinker Cope for study aboard the Teresa Kusilich, whose shipping records are still a matter of mystery. Given that these descriptions are 150 years old and based on drawings, it may be best to regard the animal as more of a paleocryptid than a solidly Oust Colossus-sized creature until more material is found. The purpose of this section is not to give any strict size estimates or taxonomy of the animal because we're working with very poor information from a time period of less standardized science, but to draw attention to the animal. If you're from New Zealand and have any experience in fossil preparation, please reach out to the Canterbury Museum and offer your services to go collect more material for Mount Potts. It's time to dig up a kaiju. If you love giant marine reptiles, please subscribe if you haven't already. Also make sure to join the channel so I can continue to bring you more paleontology videos like this one. Ichthyosaurs are some of the most amazing animals in the world, and I'm thrilled that we're always learning more about them. Learn with me by subscribing for more and commenting on what videos you'd like to see next. I'm the Vividen, and I'll see you next time.